All right. Hey guys, welcome to this special episode of the Fast Lane Car, and we're in a Rogue, a brand new Rogue, but we're not talking about the Rogue. We're going to be talking about the Tesla, and with me, if you guys recall from the last video, is our EV expert, Anton Wallman. Anton, last video, people want to know kind of what makes you an EV expert. How come you're the expert, man?
Good question. I would say I'm more self-taught than anything else, in the sense that I have been spending much of the last couple of years with most of the major automakers, and simply have been able to spend time with the people who are the true experts.
Yeah, and you know, Anton kind of is a journalist, but he takes, at least in my opinion, kind of more of an analyst approach to this business. So you study a lot about the different companies, and you happen to live kind of in the Bay Area, so I think Tesla comes naturally to you because that's the company that's driving the economy there.
That's right. That certainly was, if anything, you could argue that it's one of the instigating forces in electrification. So we had, of course, the GM car that was put out in the 1990s. And then in calendar year 2010, of course, Tesla had just brought its Roadster to the market in late 2008, which was a fairly extreme car. I mean, the car started at a price north of $100,000. And it was, you probably tried to get in and out of this thing a few times. And it's basically a small Lotus that was repurposed. So it wasn't really a practical family car, but the two first cars that really hit that were, accordingly, were the Nissan Leaf and the Chevrolet Bolt. And both of those two cars started delivering in the United States in the month of December of 2010. And that is really when we see the beginnings of mass adoption in the United States of cars that are practical, have a plug, and had a price tag sort of somewhere south of $45,000.
Yeah, so let's talk about the Model S, because that's really what this video is about. Because right now there's a lot happening with Tesla, specifically kind of going to the fact that for the first time you can afford, well, maybe you can afford a Tesla Model S, because unlike all the previous years, I think probably demand has now reached supply, and if anything, supply is starting to outstrip demand for the Model S.
Yeah, so the Model S now, the official price is $66,000 plus $1,200 for destination and delivery. That puts you at $67,200 before taxes and before discounts and incentives. And what happened here in the third quarter was that Tesla started offering various degrees of discounts for all sorts of reasons and purposes. For example, they would waive the destination fee. They would, there are stories about them simply offering discounts for cars that are sitting on the lot. So they were producing cars not that had been pre-ordered by a customer, but rather to populate their various stores and their parking garages that are located around them. So if you went into a store and said, you know what, I want a car now, today or this week, and I don't want to custom order one, I don't have any particular requirements, so they could find you one and you would get a few grand off. And that few grand, if you're buying a more expensive version of the Model S that cost well over $100,000, you could get up to, I mean, we've seen stories of people getting on the general order of $25,000, maybe more.
Wow.
Off. Now, clearly you wouldn't get that much money off of a base model, a $66,000 car, but you might have gotten at least something.
Yeah, and the reason for this video is because Tesla doesn't ever really advertise this, right? Unless you're kind of a Tesla insider, you don't know that you could potentially get $10,000 off of a Tesla right now.
No, so what they did was that, of course, they sell primarily with their own website as the main honey for the insect, as it were. And you go to their website and you start configuring a car, and at the end of that process, what shows up is that, oh, did you know that you could get something either exactly what you just configured or something very close to, maybe it was the same color, very slightly different options, or maybe with the exact same options but a slightly different color, you could get one of those. They're in stock nearby. And if you go for one of those, and they may have put just 50 miles on the odometer just to say that this thing wasn't technically 100% new, but for all intents and purposes, they were really new cars. You might have gotten $5,000 or $7,000 off.
Wow, so let's say that you're going for the base model, which is what, $60,000, right?
$66,000 plus destination and delivery, yes.
So potentially you could get not only the rebates, the federal rebate, which is significant, right?
Yeah, those are always in place, right? So the federal rebate is for those who are eligible up to $7,500. But you only get that the following tax year, right? So you get that off next year's taxes. And then, of course, there are state incentives in many states that vary all over the place. And the rules in California for this have been changing, especially this year, and they're all over the map, basically.
So let's say you're at 66, now you're at 60. In Colorado, I think it's, you know, several thousand, so you're at 58. And then there is potentially more discounts. So that's how you get to that $25,000 off of a sticker of a Model S.
Yeah, yeah, the $25,000 is specific. Those were just Tesla's own discounts on some of those in-stock cars, some of the more expensive ones. But the bottom line is exactly what you said, is that you get a whole lot off.
How about if you want to lease a car? Because that's what a lot of people do.
I don't recall the specific examples of what they had done there, because what you would do, of course, is that theoretically you would go in and you would negotiate for the cash price like you would do with any car, and then last moment, once you had agreed on what that price is, you would say, oh, I want to lease it, and then, of course, the residuals and all the payments are based off of that lower base, so presumably that would also lower the lease price from wherever it would have been to a lower number.
So let's now talk about kind of what's going on with Tesla as a company, because there is big news. I think part of this whole discounting of the Model S is because they're, in a way, cannibalizing their own Model S sales with the Model 3, right? Because people have signed up and have put down deposits. And if you put down a deposit for a Model 3, unless Tesla can convince you to put that money down, which you're trying to do on a Model S, right, you're kind of waiting for the Model 3. So realistically, when will Tesla start building a Model 3?
Very good question. So you're bringing up a most interesting and important phenomenon, and that is to the degree that Tesla has started so-called Osborne-ing itself with having announced the Model 3. So if you're on the fence and you weren't in an urgent need to get a car, you would simply make the calculation that by waiting for the Model 3, I'd save at a minimum $30,000 to $35,000, and I would get a car that, for all intents and purposes, would deliver close to 90% or some number close to that of what a Model S does. And that would certainly cause some people to wait. And you could say that, oh, it's going to be a slightly smaller car. To be sure, a very slightly smaller car. On the other hand, it will probably have some new things that the current Model S doesn't have. I mean, you look at the interior fundamentally in the Model S hasn't changed much. They upgraded the seats, there have been some very minor changes. But you would imagine that all sorts of new technologies and a whole new level of refinement would find itself into the Model 3 that simply was not present in the Model S. So you could, in part, get a better car by waiting.
Why is that called Osborne-ing yourself?
Well, there's a long story to that. You could probably look it up. But there was this idea that if as a company you announced the next product, the next model, the next version,
right?
People would simply not buy the current one. And that's why automakers, Apple does not announce the iPhone 9 or iPhone 10, right? They announce the next one and they do it a week or two or three before the new iPhone comes out, because otherwise the sales of the current version is going to come to a halt.
So the question is, why did Tesla announce the Model 3 so early? Because they needed that money for the deposits, you think?
Well, yes and no. I think they didn't actually need the money for the deposits, because let's say that the number that Tesla has announced is that in May they announced 373,000 deposits, 373,000. They haven't updated that number since. And the deposits were in the United States, $1,000. Abroad, the number might have been slightly different because of currency exchange and other reasons. So, but let's say it's 1,000, right? So that's basically translates to $373 million. Let's call that $400 million. For Tesla to get essentially a $400 million prepayment, is not a lot at the end of the day. I think that in my opinion, it was done in order to excite essentially the investment markets. so that they could actually go out and raise money based on the prospects of having this product and having this sort of pent-up demand for it, which is exactly what happened, because in the third week of May, Tesla did go out and raise approximately $1.7 billion in selling new stock. So that is exactly what happened.
Yeah, so it worked for them in one way, but it also probably made the Model S a lot more
affordable. It was certainly a double-edged sword. That is exactly correct. Now, to your other question, which is where we were getting with all of this, when can we expect the Model 3? What the company has officially said is that everybody internally and externally to the company, and external to the company, I mean suppliers and so forth, they've all been told that this car needs to be in production July 1st of next year. Now, keep in mind here that the definition of production differs from automaker to automaker, and in this particular case, most automakers tend to have one definition of production, and Tesla has another one. And in this case, this moment in time, July 1st of 2017, is one where they really are going to be able to push one car across the assembly line.
Now,
what happens with a normal automaker is that they do that and they make, you know, 500 cars, maybe another 500 after that. They take those cars, they drive them for anywhere between sort of 15 months and 2.5 years. Around the world, they drive them in the deserts. They drive them in the up in the tundra. Drive them. They just completely wear them down to ensure that panel gaps and they no shakes and rattles or squeaks or parts falling off. And then once they have wrung those deficiencies out of the product, then something called SOP or SORP, start of production or start of regular production, commences. And we have a case right now with, say, Volkswagen in Tennessee, where they're going to be building this three-row SUV that has been in the works for so many years.
Forever.
They started building those bodies, you know, last year. The start of a regular production starts supposedly this December. So that's like at least a full year from when they started building these bodies on the assembly line until they start making cars that are available for sale to the general consumer. So in this case, in the case of Tesla, what they will most likely do, I believe, is that they will be selling the first couple of thousand units, some number, maybe it's 1,000, maybe it's 3,000, somewhere in that general ballpark, to their own employees. How much will they pay for these cars? Who knows? I would have to believe that if you're going to be a guinea pig for a product like that, you had better get a one hefty discount. But the point is nevertheless the same. The point is that their own employees are going to be spending at a minimum several months, probably close to a year, wringing out all of the initial issues with the car that every car has when it goes into initial production. So, and then after that, the people who are officially in line, most of these, the vast majority of these 373,000 people, if their deposits are still there, by that time, they will start to take deliveries probably sometime well into 2018, is my belief. Is that, I mean, maybe they'll deliver a small number, maybe a few hundred, maybe even 1,000 or whatever, but I don't think they'll be delivering very many of them until we're very, very deep into 2018.
You know, that's like the best case scenario, because Tesla has always had a history of coming late with the cars they promised, right? The Model X was very late. It was years, it wasn't months.
Yeah, basically 2 years.
Yeah.
I mean, when the car was first announced, in February of 2012, it was promised that the car was going to be delivered by the end of 2013. They delivered at a ceremony at the end of September 2015, like not even 10 cars. And by December of 2015, we're talking a couple hundred, not even.
Yeah.
And then, of course, meaningful delivery started right about the Christmas time of 2015. How to say meaningful? They're still not really meaningful, but, you know, at least more than, you know, a couple of dozen a week.
So and in all that time, the Bolt's going to be selling, the new Leaf's going to be selling, you know.
That's right. So the first one there is clearly the Bolt. The Bolt starts deliveries here this December, probably in California, and then in the handful of months thereafter, geographic availability of that car will spread throughout the country to Oregon and what have you in the early part of 2017. So in the first quarter of 2017, you'll probably see it in a dozen or so states. The Nissan Leaf 2.0, or whatever it will be called, I mean, we don't even know that what Nissan is going to call its next generation electric car. They haven't said. I mean, I'm using Leaf 2.0 conceptually. Most people seem to believe that it will be in U.S. dealerships in the second half of 2017.
Yeah, and, and we're talking about these cars because all three cars have over 200 miles of EV range.
That's right. They're all going to be very similar and in one level.
This keeps beeping at me because it's the lane departure.
I know.
I don't know where to turn it off, dude.
I don't know. I wouldn't worry about it. We'll just have to live with it.
Okay,
it's not the end of the world.
Yeah, it's not the end of the world.
No.
So that's why we're talking about these three cars, which kind of brings me back to the Model S again, Anton, and that is they're going to have to sell the Model S for at least two more years and more likely 3 years. And are there any updates coming to this car, or is it going to be the same old Model S that's going to soldier on until...
Well, the Model S just received a sort of a mid-cycle front fascia update
with
a new cone, nose cone in May.
Yeah.
So I don't expect anything on the exterior anytime soon. You could envision an interior freshening, like more richer interior door panels, that sort of thing. I don't think it's the company's priority, frankly. I think the company has other higher order issues it needs to resolve, its cost structure, the cost of the car, and so forth. And most fundamentally, in the near term, just getting this assembly line for the Model 3 built. I mean, they're going to be building many cars, right? So I'll just give you a comparative example. You take Infiniti, since we're sitting in a Nissan here. Infiniti is Nissan's premium brand. They're building a large number of different sort of sedan, coupe, and various crossover and SUV models. They're building them right now in four factories, with a fifth one coming online by the end of 2017. I forget the exact numbers, but I think they're doing on the general order about 200,000 cars a year. So they're a company that is now, I mean, Tesla wants to go to 500,000 cars per year as an exit rate in 2018. That's what they've said from one factory. So Nissan today has four factories for the Infiniti, one in England, one in Tennessee, and two in Japan, a fifth one coming online in Mexico at the end of 2017. So for a company that's doing about 200,000 cars a year, say, maybe they'll grow to 250,000, 280,000 cars a year by end of next year or by early 2018. But that's that. At that time, it'll be five factories spitting out products for a company that is going to be on the general order of half the size of where Tesla says it wants to be in 2018 with one factory. Now ask yourself, A, how realistic is that? And B, what is the risk associated with having all that production in one place? Being the only, may I add, the only volume manufacturer at that point in the state of California. There's no other final assembly line for a volume automaker anymore in California.
So let's discount any kind of, personnel trouble, which is common in the auto industry. So let's discount that. Let's just talk about like...
Roman?
Graveyards
are filled with indispensable men. So you can always survive some people falling off a cliff, right? I mean, that has happened before. Right. It will happen again. So I don't think... the fact that there will be some key engineer here or there leaving is going to, in and of itself, because if that were the case, almost any company in the world would be dead in no time. But anyway,
the logistics of this, to build three different cars on the same factory floor.
Oh, it can be done, all right. That is being done in all sorts of factories. I'm just saying that they've got to build an actual assembly line and then wring out the issues with it and then live with the risk of having your entire production in one factory for the foreseeable future. Those are not entirely trivial issues.
Yeah.
And other auto companies have ways around them. They spread them across multiple factories, and they have not promised these types of timelines. So when they come out with a car, the car has already been tested for years with their own internal employees before the end user starts to get their hands on them. And those cars are never sold. Those cars are never ultimately distributed. They're crushed at the end of the rainbow.
Yeah, and I think the Model X is a perfect example of that process not working so well with Tesla, because let's face it, the first Model X's that came out, and I haven't seen the new ones, were relatively, not the highest quality of cars. The molding didn't fit right. There was all kinds of production issues with the Model X.
Yeah, I mean, this was a case, this was, I think, exemplifies this precisely in that that car did not spend enough time.
Yeah, it was stillborn in some ways.
Yeah, I mean, first of all, we could argue whether these doors and so forth will ever work
right,
properly.
Yeah.
I mean, we have yet to see them really survive in terms of broad distribution and meaningful numbers. Customers that live in very harsh climates, meaning up in the icy, cold northern states and on this continent as well as in Europe. So that has, you know, you just give it a couple of really harsh winters, we'll see how it goes. And for that matter, extreme heats, I guess, because at some point that also wears on things. But so you have design issues and you have testing issues. And let's say that there ultimately, there is no design issue for the sake of argument. You still have to, even if you have a quote unquote safe design with no weir doors, no this, no that, well, you still have to wring out the issues. And that's why all the other automakers are spending so much time taking their cars on these long, long drives around the clock from Namibia to Alaska and everything in between.
So let me wrap this up. I guess my takeaway from this conversation is that it's a really good time to buy a Model S right now because the car has gone through that kind of rigorous process over the years, right?
The Model S has certainly wrung out most of these issues ostensibly, and they have been given good discounts now. The question is for how long that will work. It's clearly they needed to, you know, have a big quarter here, which they're going to report here right after the end of the month, when they'll have delivered well over 20,000 cars, maybe closer to 25,000. I think they'll have a big number there. So basically the lesson learned is, you know, if you give people enough of a discount, you can push volumes through very, very quickly. Now the question then becomes, of course, have you now conditioned your customers to wait until the last month? So if you have done that, then in the future, maybe customers will be simply holding off buying a car until the very end of the quarter because they know that as the third month in the quarter arrives, you can buy it for many, many thousands less off the lot. So that remains to be seen, but I guess we'll know that closer to December.
So if I were in a market for a Model S, I think this is a great time to go buy one right now. And if you guys are holding off for the Model 3, maybe you should seriously consider getting the car that's available as opposed to the car that might not be available for at least another 2 years.
Well, that's certainly what Tesla has been encouraging the people who are on the list to do, right? So the people that put down a deposit or two or more, what they did was they got contacted by Tesla and said, look, we have a car for you. We can basically give it to you at a discounted price from list today, and you can be in a car for, yes, it's a lot more than $35,000, but you can have one right now. And obviously a lot of people are going to say, well, thanks, but no thanks. But some people are going to say, well, you know, I'm feeling bullish today. I'm impatient. Something just dropped into my lap. I've got an extra 30-35K sitting here, and it's time to rock and roll. So they clearly were able to harvest some of these sales here in the third quarter, and I think we'll see that when the sales results are reported here in about a week.
I have a friend, and this is going to date me, but I had one of the first iPods, and he was waiting for the newest one, and I was like, man, you're lucky, you're going to be able to buy the new one. And he's like, no, you're lucky, because you've got to use yours for the last year when I didn't have the chance to use it. And so there is a lot to be said about having actually, you know, driving an electric car as opposed to waiting for one for 3 years. What are the residuals like on the Model S?
You know, the debates vary on this because Tesla now leases them themselves, you know, they're leasing, there are so many, that gets so level steep. There's a lot of debate about what they are. So you have to look at, there's a difference between the price at which Tesla sells its used cars, kind of in the CPO market, versus what, the best verdict on this, just go to eBay, basically. Look at not what the asking prices are, but go to eBay and look at what the actual transaction prices are. And I think you'll get a good sense of what you can expect. And that is probably the more realistic numbers.
Well, Anton, thank you very much for once again bringing us up to date with what's happening with Tesla. And if people want to find you, where do they go and find your writing?
I publish primarily on a website called seekingalpha.com. Just one word, seekingalpha.com. I also publish less frequently on thestreet.com. So you can go there and just basically hit it up in the comment section.
Yeah, because this man knows electric cars backwards and forwards. It's more of an analyst view of the industry than of a journalist view. And I always find it interesting to kind of get the, you know, pull the curtain back and see what's happening behind the veil as opposed to what's happening in front of the veil. So thanks for taking the time to chat with me. I really appreciate it.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Hey guys, welcome to Miami, where Nissan just rolled out the 2017 Rogue, and behind us is a brand new Rogue. It's the hybrid, and this is Ty Webb. This is your baby, right, Ty?
Yep,
this is my Nissan baby. So walk me through it. Tell me about the styling.
Okay, all right, so we've completely redone the front end, as you can see here. So we have integrated LED daytime running lamps. We have LED headlamps. We've redesigned.